union and intersection of subgroups. If H1 and H2 are two subgroups of a group G, then the intersection, namely H1 intersection H2, is also a subgroup of G. Proof: let H1 and H2 be two subgroups of G. We have to show that their intersection, namely H1 intersection H2, is also a subgroup of G. We know that H is a non-empty complex of a group G, then the necessary and sufficient condition for H to be a subgroup of G is A comma B belong to H implies A into B inverse belongs to H, where B inverse is the inverse of B in G. Using this statement, to prove that H1 intersection H2 is a subgroup of G, it is enough to show that A comma B belong to H1 intersection H2 implies A into B inverse belongs to H1 intersection H2. That is, to prove H1 intersection H2 is a subgroup of G, it is enough to prove that A comma B belong to H1 intersection H2 implies AB inverse belongs to H1 intersection H2. Let A belong to H1 intersection H2. This implies, since A belongs to the intersection, it means A belongs to H1 and A belongs to H2. H2. B belongs to H1 intersection H2 implies B belongs to H1 and, that is, intersection is replaced by and, B belongs to H2. What is H1? H1 is a subgroup of G. Therefore, A comma B belong to H1 implies AB inverse belongs to H1 by the theorem just now we have stated. Similarly, H2 is a subgroup of G. Therefore, A comma B belong to H2 implies AB inverse belongs to H2. Thus, A comma B belong to H1 and H2 implies AB inverse belongs to H1 and AB inverse belong to H2. That is, the element AB inverse belongs to both H1 and H2. Therefore, AB inverse belongs to H1 and AB inverse belongs to H2. This and is replaced by intersection. This implies AB inverse belongs to H1 intersection H2. Thus, A comma B belong to H1 intersection H2 implies AB inverse belongs to H1 intersection H2. Hence, H1 intersection H2 is a subgroup. Note, H1 intersection H2 is the largest subgroup of G contained in H1 and H2. The above theorem can be extended to intersection of any number of subgroups of a group. Now, union of two subgroups of a group need not be a subgroup. We will justify the above statement with an example. We know that the set of integers with respect to addition is a group. Let us take H1 is equals to the set containing all negative values minus 6, minus 4, minus 2, that is all negative even integers 0, 2, 4, 6, so on. That is nothing but 2 times set of integers, that is even integers, set of even integers. H1 consists of set of even integers, is a subgroup of the set of integer Z. H2 is equal to the set containing minus 9, minus 6, minus 3, 0, 3, 6, 9, so on. That is all multiples of 3. That is 3 times set of integers is also a subgroup of is z. It is very easy to show that 2z and 3z both are subgroups of the set of integers z. Now what is H1 union H2? H1 union H2 consists of all the elements of H1 and all the elements of H2. If at all any repetition is there, we write only once. Now this contains all even integers and multiples of 3. That is the set containing elements, comma, minus 9, minus 8, minus 6, minus 4, minus 3, minus 2, 0, 2, 3, 4, 6, 8, 9, so on. Now let us choose two elements from here. 2 belongs to H1 union H2, 3 is also is there. 2 and 3 both are the elements of H1 union H2. This implies 2 plus 3 equal to 5. We know that 2 plus 3 equal to 5. Here the operation is the addition. What about 5? Does it belong to H1 union H2? Do you find 5 here? No. Because after 0 we have a 2. After 2 we have 3. After 3 we have 4. After 4 we have 6. 5 is not here. 5 is missing. Therefore this 5 does not belong to H1 union H2. That is, the closure axiom fails. We have chosen two elements from the set H1 union H2, namely 2, 3. If we add, because the binary operation is plus here, if we add this 2 plus 3 equal to 5, which does not belong to the set H1 union H2. Therefore, the closure axiom fails, and hence H1 union H2 is not a subgroup of Z. Thus, union of two subgroups of a group need not be a subgroup of the group. Let us recall some results from set theory. Let the set A equals to the set containing the elements 1, 2, 3, 4 and the set B equals to the set 2, 4. That is, A has 4 elements, B has only 2 elements. Now look at the elements of B. It has 2 elements, they are 2 and 4. And these 2 elements are in A. That is, 2 is an element of B, the 2 is in A. 4 is an element of B, the 4 is also in A. That is, every element of B is in A. Therefore, B is a proper subset of A. And A is not a subset of B because there is number 1 in A which is not in B. Therefore, here B is a proper subset of A and it is denoted by B subset of A. This symbol stands for proper subset. So B is a proper subset of A, or we call A as a superset of B. So B is a proper subset of A. What is A union B here? When you say A union B, we have to write all the elements of A and all the elements of B. If at all any elements is repeated, generally we write only once, and hence A union B is A has elements 1, 2, 3, 4. We have written elements of A. Now we have to write the elements of B. 2, already we have written, 4, already we have written, and hence A union B equals to the set 1, 2, 3, 4. What is this set 1, 2, 3, 4? Nothing but A. And hence A union B equals to A. Why it happens so? Because B is a subset of A. Therefore, whenever B is a proper subset of A, A union B will be A. And A intersection B will be B. That's the result. B subset of A implies and implied by A union B equals to A. Let us consider another set of sets. A equals to 1, 2, 3, 4 and B has elements 3 and 5. Here the common element is only 3. 3 is the only common element. And 5 is in B which is not in A and hence B is not a subset of A. What is A union B? Let us write all the elements of A and B. 1, 2, 3, 4. When you come to B, already we have written 3 and 5, we have to write 5. Therefore, A union B equals to the set containing elements 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 which contains 5 elements. The first result is A is not a subset of B. Then there exists some element in A which is not in B. For example, there exists 1 belongs to A but 1 does not belong to B. B is not a subset of A. Then there exists some element in B which is not in A. For example, here 5 belongs to B but 5 is not in A. So in general, if A is not a subset of B, then there exists A belongs to capital A and this A does not belong to B. With the above two examples, we can generalize the result. A is not a subset of B, then there exists A belongs to A and A does not belong to B. The second result is 2 belongs to A implies 2 belongs to A union B. Because when you say union, we have to write elements of A as well as B. 2 belongs to A, also the 2 belongs to A union B. Similarly, suppose B belongs to B, then B belongs to A union B. For example, 5 belongs to B. 5 belongs to A union B. Therefore, when you say some element belongs to A, the same element must belong to A union B. So in general, small a belongs to A implies small a belongs to A union B. The third result is 2 belongs to A union B. Yes, it is 2 which belongs to A union B. This implies 2 belongs to A. Yes, right. Or 2 belongs to B. 2 belongs to A or 2 belongs to B. Does 2 belong to B? No. But 2 belongs to A. That is true. But in general, what happens when you say A belongs to A union B, then you can say that either A belongs to capital A or small a belongs to capital B. One more example. Let us take 5 belongs to A union B. This implies 5 belongs to A or 5 belongs to B. But does 5 belong to A? No. 5 does not belong to A. But 5 belongs to B. So in general, X belongs to A union B implies either X belongs to A or X belongs to B. The union of two subgroups of a group is a subgroup if and only if one is contained in another. We know that in general, union of two subgroups of a group need not be a subgroup. But this statement says that union of two subgroups of a group is a subgroup if and only if one is contained in another. That is, if H1 and H2 are two subgroups of a group G, then H1 union H2 is a subgroup of G if and only if H1 is contained in H2 or H2 is contained in H1. Let us prove the statement now. Let H1 and H2 be two subgroups of G and assume that H1 union H2 is also a subgroup of G. We will now prove that H1 is contained in H2 or H2 is contained in H1. If possible, let us suppose that H1 is not contained in H2 and H2 is not contained in H1. Since H1 is not contained in H2, this implies there exists H1 belongs to capital H1, but this small h1 does not belong to H2. This is the one we have already discussed. Suppose A is not contained in B, then there exists one belongs to A, but the one is not in B. Similarly, if B is not contained in A, then there exists 5 belongs to B, but 5 does not belong to A. Therefore, in general, if A is not contained in B, then there exists the element in A which is not in B. Since H1 is not contained in H2, there exists an element H1 in capital H1, but the same H1 is not in H2. Similarly, since H2 is not contained in H1, this implies that there exists H2 in capital H2, but the same H2 not in H1. Let us call it as 2. Since H1 belongs to capital H1, this implies H1 belongs to union, namely H1 union H2. This also we already discussed with an example. That is, 2 belongs to A and 2 also belongs to A union B. Similarly, if 5 belongs to B, then 5 also belongs to A union B. So, in general, A belongs to A implies A belongs to A union B. Therefore, H1 belongs to H1, capital H1, implies H1 belongs to capital H1 union H2. Similarly, small h2 is in capital H2. This implies small h2 belongs to H1 union H2. Let us go and combine these two. This implies H1 belongs to H1 union H2. H2 belongs to H1 union H2. What is H1 union H2? H1 union H2 is a subgroup, and hence H1 union H2 is a group by itself. Therefore, by closure property, H1 belongs to H1 union H2 and H2 belongs to H1 union H2 implies H1 into H2 belongs to H1 union H2. Since H1 union H2 is a subgroup and by closure property, H1 into H2 belongs to H1 union H2. Now, H1 into H2 belongs to H1 union H2 by closure property. This implies either H1 into H2 belongs to H1 or H1 into H2 belongs to capital H2. This also we already discussed with an example. This is the one. 2 belongs to A union B implies 2 belongs to A or 2 belongs to B. But in this case, 2 belongs to A. 5 belongs to A union B implies 5 belongs to A or 5 belongs to B. But 5 belongs to B is the correct one here. Any one is true or both can be true. So, in general, X belongs to A union B implies X belongs to A or because of union, we write R. If it is intersection, we have to replace intersection by AND. Therefore, X belongs to A union B implies X belongs to A or X belongs to B. That's the one we have written here. H1 into H2 belongs to H1 union H2. This implies H1, H2 belongs to H1 or H1 into H2 belongs to H2. Let us take H1 into H2 belongs to capital H1. Since H1 belongs to H1, already we have taken, and H1 is a subgroup, therefore inverse exists for every element, and hence inverse exists for H1 also. Therefore, H1 belongs to capital H1 implies small h1 inverse belongs to capital H1. Now, we have two elements in H1. One is H1 into H2. The another element is H1 inverse. And H1 is a group. Therefore, by closure axiom, the product namely H1 inverse and H1 H2 must be in H1. This implies H1 inverse into H1 is identity. That is E. E into H2 is H2. Therefore, the above one implies H2 belongs to capital H1. Is this correct? We already mentioned that in the previous slide, H2 is not contained in H1 implies there exists. H2 belongs to H2, but H2 does not contain in H1. And here we have shown that H2 belongs to capital H1. So, which is a contradiction. Here by hypothesis, H2 does not belong to H1. Now, in the process, we have shown that H2 belongs to capital H1, which is a contradiction. Why this contradiction arises? The reason is, the assumption that H1 is not contained in H2 and H2 is not contained in H1 is wrong. This is the one we already assumed. Therefore, we have to change our assumption. Because of this contradiction, what we assumed, namely H1 not contained in H2 and H2 not contained in H1 is wrong. Therefore, either H1 is contained in H2 or H2 is contained in H1. This completes the first part of the proof. Now, let us prove the second part of the proof. Conversely, H1 and H2 are two subgroups of a group G. And H1 is contained in H2 or H2 is contained in H1. Now, we have to show that the union, namely H1 union H2, is a subgroup of G. That is, claim H1 union H2 is a subgroup of G. Since H1 is contained in H2, this is a hypothesis in the converse part. We have H1 union H2 equals to H2. This is the one we already discussed with an example. That is, whenever B is contained in A, A union B equals to A. Here, H1 is contained in H2. Therefore, H2 is equals to H1 union H2. Thus, H1 union H2 equal to H2. What is H2? H2 is a subgroup of G. But H2 is exactly same as H1 union H2. Since H2 is a subgroup, H1 union H2 is a subgroup of G. So, this implies H1 union H2 is a subgroup of G. Because H2 is a subgroup of G. Similarly, H2 is contained in H1. This implies H1 union H2 is equal to H1. Since H1 is a subgroup of G and H1 is equals to H1 union H2, this implies that H1 union H2 is a subgroup of G. Because H1 is a subgroup of G. Thus, H1 union H2 is a subgroup of G. Thus, if H1 and H2 are subgroup of G, then H1 union H2 is a subgroup of G, if and only if H1 is contained in H2 or H2 is contained in H1. In these two parts, the first part was H1 and H2 are subgroup of G and H1 union H2 is also subgroup, then we have proved this part. In the second part, H1 and H2 are subgroup of a group G. H1 is contained in H2 or H2 is contained in H1, then we proved H1 union H2. So, in this case, the H1 and H2 are subgroup of a group G is common for both part. If G is equals to the set 1 minus 1 I minus I is a group under multiplication, then we will find all the subgroup of the group G. Given G is a set having elements 1 minus 1 I minus I is a group under multiplication, we have already proved this. Here 1 is the identity in G. Clearly 1 and G are trivial improper subgroup of G. And remember that for any group, the identity element itself forms a group and that group is called a trivial or improper subgroup of the given group. And the group G itself is a group, and this group is also known as trivial subgroup of the group G. Therefore, for any group, there are two improper or trivial subgroups. They are the identity element alone and the group G itself. Let us consider H is equal to 1, comma, minus 1. This is a set containing two elements 1 and minus 1. Clearly, H is a subset of G because the elements of H are in G. Clearly, H is a group. We can verify this. 1 and minus 1, 1 minus 1. See the composition table. 1 into 1 is 1, 1 into minus 1 is minus 1, minus 1 into 1 is minus 1, minus 1 into minus 1 is 1. Since H has two elements, this composition table has four elements, namely 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1, and all these four elements are from H only. Therefore, all the elements in the composition table are elements of H, and hence H is closed. And the number 1 and minus 1 are rational numbers, and we know that rational numbers obey associative property. Look at the first row headed by the number 1, that is the row having elements 1 and minus 1, and this first row is exactly same as the topmost row, and hence the row headed by number 1 is the identity element. That is, the number 1 is the identity element. Now clearly, the inverse of 1 is 1 because 1 is the identity, and the inverse of identity is always itself. Also, if you want to find the inverse of 1, consider the row headed by 1. Where is the identity element here? 1 is the identity element, and hence the corresponding element 1 in the topmost row is the inverse of 1. Now, how do you find the inverse of minus 1? For that, we have to consider the row headed by the element minus 1. The row headed by minus 1 having elements minus 1 and 1. Between these two, 1 is the identity element, and hence the corresponding element in the topmost row is minus 1. Therefore, inverse of minus 1 is minus 1. Thus, inverse of 1 is 1, inverse of minus 1 is minus 1. That is, if the elements of H have its own inverse, self-inverse. Thus, H satisfies all the four axioms of a group, and hence H is a group. Since H is a subset of G, and H is a subgroup of G. Since H is a subset of G, H is a subgroup of G. There is no other subgroup of G. And remember that any subgroup must contain the identity element of the group. Therefore, here H also contains the identity element 1 of the group G. Thus, all the subgroups of G are 1, 1 and minus 1, and the group namely 1 minus 1, I minus I. Thus, this group has 3 subgroups. Out of 3 subgroups, 2 subgroups are trivial, and the last one, namely H is equal to 1 and minus 1, is a non-trivial subgroup, or we say proper subgroup of G. Note, any group having more than one element has at least 2 subgroups. The first one is the identity element E itself. The second one is the given group G itself.